Hello to everybody, to all the people that have been connected to this online seminar. With this seminar today, we try to recover from all the year. And as you might remember, we used to do these seminars of presenting the research of these visiting fellows we had from our program. And it was something quite informal. So we used to invite up to 10 people to the institute so the researchers could present the initial ideas of the research they were carrying out in Barcelona. So we could have an exchange of ideas, which was in a cozy environment. As the year has gone, as it went, we couldn't do that. Actually, just before the lockdown, and Nikos had to come to the institute. It was planned for the 10th or no, for the 17th of March. So imagine, I mean, it caught us just when we started. So, okay, we decided we had to do it in any case, and this is the presentation. So Nikos will present the research he carried out at the Pompeu Fabra during the time he was in Barcelona, because he stayed in Barcelona. And the idea is a 30-minute presentation, maybe shorter if he can. And then just any question you have, Ander will explain to you how to do it, and that will be it. And welcome back to the online institute of everybody's house. In the real sense of the word. Okay, so Ander, you explain the situation.
Yeah, sure. Thanks, Mireia, and thank everyone for attending this seminar that, as Mireia has rightly said, will be in a sort of familiar and informal level, but that does not, of course, take out the fact that we will go into very deep issues on Nikos' presentation, Professor Skoutaris' presentation. And regarding the dynamic, basically, it will be, as Mireia has rightly said, we will be 30, 35 minutes with Nikos' presentation. As you may have noticed, we are having this sort of format because the part of the event's presentation and Nikos' lecture or presentation will be recorded, or is actually being recorded right now. And therefore, in order not you not being in the record, we thought that it would be easier to keep you as attendees. And then once Nikos has ended his presentation, we will upgrade you, so to say, as panelists, so that we can have the open discussion in a equal level. Regarding the discussion, I will ask you to put your name in the chat if you have any questions, so that Mireia, who will be moderating the discussion, can follow the order in a proper manner. So whenever you have a question, you just put your name in the chat, and then that will be it. So if you agree, then I will give pass to Nico so that he can make his presentation, and I will okay. I will switch off my camera in order to leave the presenter only in the recording, and I will downgrade Mireia, sorry, as attendees until Nikos has. Well, first I will leave Mireia present Nikos, and then I will downgrade you. So thanks, Nikos, for being here, and Mireia, the floor is yours. Mireia,
micrófono. I will not gain my life being a TV presenter. So here there is Nikos Skoutaris. I mean, it was last during the all this year has been a visiting researcher with a grant from the 2019 program, actually. He presented a project that really fit our objectives at the Institute. I mean, secession, European Union, from a broader perspective that we were doing. So he's been here the 6 months. Well, he was. And if you can just present the initial objective of what you've done, and then we carry on with the presentation, and see you later.
Well, I mean, first of all, thank you very much for the invitation. I hope you can all see me and hear me. So indeed, I was one of the lucky recipients of the fellowship last year. I had my sabbatical. My plan was to spend my sabbatical in Barcelona doing this project on self-determination in EU law. And indeed, with Mireia, we arranged this presentation to take place in March of last year. But as you all know, what happened? It was a rather unfortunate event with the lockdown because, I mean, part of my the reason why I wanted to have this fellowship in Barcelona was precisely to actually have the opportunity to exchange my ideas with the academic community there, which was, of course, very, very difficult given the lockdown. So instead, we are having this presentation here. I'm speaking in London, where I live. Behind me, you can see the school of my son, and here is our Christmas tree. So in a very, very different environment than the one that normally this presentation should have taken place some months ago. If that's okay with all of you, and if there's any problem, just let me know. I will now try to share my screen in order for you to actually be able to see my presentation. Okay, so normally you should be able now to see my my screen, but if there are any problems, let me know.
I confirm that everything is fine, Nikos. Thanks.
Perfect. 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 Thanks, Andrea. So the title of the presentation is The Right of Self-Determination in the EU Constitutional Order. This is a paper that I have been working on for the last year and a half. And my goal is actually to submit it during the next couple of months in a journal. So it's almost written, but I would really appreciate any feedback. And I'm also happy to share the written version of it to whoever is interested once it's finalized. Just to before I get to the argument that I'm making, just let me position this this paper in the broader framework of my work. So I have been working on issues of secession and self-determination pretty much throughout my academic career. So my first PhD and my first monograph, which you can see on the left, was about pretty much how EU law has addressed one of the oldest secessionist conflicts in Europe, the one in Cyprus. In particular, I'm looking at how EU law has applied with regard to the north of Cyprus. My second monograph, which I am finalizing this year, thankfully and finally, is about the right of internal self-determination. So I'm looking how EU law tries to deal with what we call internal self-determination. So how the different systems of divisions of competences within Europe, within the EU, have been accommodated. And because I have been working on those issues for the last 4 years that Brexit is on the news, I have been working also as a consultant for the European Left Party, especially with regard to Northern Ireland and how EU law can accommodate the very special situation in Northern Ireland and the territorial border on the island of Ireland. So, the paper that I'm presenting today, in a way, is an amalgamation. It's kind of the byproduct of many years of work, and also, in a way, an amalgamation of different, slightly different strands of my research: external self-determination, internal self-determination, EU law, and if there is one line that I think that my research has kind of highlighted is precisely the flexibility of the EU constitutional order of state. So what I have been arguing time and again in all those publications is that actually EU law is way more flexible than it's often credited for, and also that it is in a position to actually accommodate this kind of tensions, divisions, and frictions that come from those huge political problems. And this paper does exactly that. This paper actually tries to actually position itself and situates itself within this broader debate about self-determination in Europe, and tries to show exactly that. Actually, EU law, the EU political and constitutional order is flexible enough to kind of accommodate the tensions and the frictions that are created by self-determination conflicts in Europe. So I will develop my argument in five stages. The first one will be very, very descriptive. What I'm going to say is just going to present a bit the debate. I'm going to explain what is the thesis of the paper, so what is the main argument. Then I want to look very, very briefly on the right of self-determination in international law. I'm not going to spend too much time on that because I'm pretty sure that you are very well versed on the argument. And then I will try to apply to speak a bit about the main part of the paper, which is the self-determination in the right of self-determination in EU law. And I will conclude with two remarks, two broader remarks that hopefully will help us frame the debate and the Q&A discussion later. Now, normally, when I present this paper, and I think this is the fifth or sixth time that I'm presenting this paper, I spend some time in this part in order to explain to the audience what is this about? What's the problem here? I mean, but you know, for this audience, I don't think that I have to say too much. I mean, you are well versed on the problem of self-determination and how EU law deals with it. However, I want to take 5 minutes and to refer to a historical anecdote that can actually help us understand the problem. So the year is 2014. It's the night of the 18th of September, so the night that we were all expecting the results of the Scottish referendum. It's around midnight here in the UK. There are no exit polls. We don't know what is the result, so everything is up in the air. And the BBC had invited Mr. Íñigo Méndez de Vigo, the then Secretary of State for the European Union of Spanish State, to give his view on the whole issue. And one of the points that the then Secretary of State did was actually that for us, it doesn't matter what would be the result of this process, of this vote. If Scotland becomes independent and wants to remain in the EU, it has to join the queue of candidate states. And we have significant reservations as to when and how and if and whether they will ever gonna join the EU. Now, I think this short historical anecdote that largely forgotten points to two important issues that underpin this debate. The first one is that the whole issue of self-determination in Europe, as many other issues when it comes to European Union law, underline this idea of the multi-level constitutional order. Why is that? Because the successful expression of the right of self-determination within the European Union triggers points also the change of status of a certain certain political entity. What do I mean by that? A region of a member state that wants and achieves somehow to become independent has also some kind of, most of them, some kind of European aspirations. So in a way, the expression and how the exercise of the right of self-determination is also an exercise in changing the status within EU law, right? So it is one of those occasions that we see this idea of the multi-level constitutional order of states at its clear, right? So how you change status within the EU. And the second point that this historical anecdote reminds us is also the very political nature of this debate, and how here we are having a very clear example of a situation where, in an already very difficult political process that the self-determination movement always is, the parties in the conflict always try to use the different forum, the EU, the Council of Europe, etc., in order to translate a gender conflict and kind of gain points, right? So here, although the we have a situation that didn't quite directly influence the Spanish political order, it was very clear that the minister had in mind the situation in Spain and wanted to make sure that he would use the self-determination situation of Scotland in order to score points within the national arena. So we're talking about a debate that underlines both the very political nature of this debate, this idea that law is used as a sword, and the different sides use legal arguments against each other in order to translate their political arguments, but also this idea that the EU is one an arena, a forum where this debate is taking place. Now, the photos that I have used here, I mean, some of them are quite well known, and they underline this idea that regions like Scotland or Catalonia, they want to, not at least part of those nations, want to be part of the EU and change their status. But this is a debate that doesn't happen only in those well-known cases. It's a debate that happens also in Cyprus, and that's the photo on the bottom right, where you have one part of Cyprus that is not a non-recognized entity, but its people, by and large, aspire to be part of the EU, but also happens outside the EU, in the sense that we have some cases, like the case about Western Sahara, where we see that EU institutions take a stance over self-determination conflict that happens outside their borders. And obviously in cases like Bosnia, and that's the photo on the top of your screen, where you have clearly a candidate state with where there are secessionist tensions and how the EU has them. So it is a debate that is both political and legal by its very nature. And in a way, this debate at its most, well, let's put it the other way around. So when it comes to how the people and the academics are positioning themselves within this debate, when it comes to regions that already are in the EU, like Scotland was and Catalonia is, there are two big schools of thought. So there are those people that they are saying, you know what, we are talking about nations and regions that they want to remain in the EU, so EU law should be very favorable, and the EU legal order should be very favorable to those nations that are already part of the EU and they want to remain part of the EU. And under the other contingent that has been depicted very well and represented by Joseph Weiler, who are saying that, you know what, secession by itself is a negation of the European project. By actually wanting to secede, you kind of put yourself outside the European ethos, right? It's more of a moral than a legal argument, but still it's an argument that has gained traction in many, many different places. Now, my paper is actually showing and wants to actually tries to prove that, in fact, when it comes to the EU constitutional order of states, and that's my thesis, the EU is pretty much following the position of international law. So it respects self-determination when it comes to colonial entities, non-self-governing entities. It is a constitutional order that tries to accommodate as much as possible internal self-determination. And when it comes to external self-determination, it actually is flexible enough to accommodate secession, accommodate external self-determination, following the correct treaty procedure. So my argument is, to make a long story short, that the EU legal order is able to accommodate, is flexible enough to accommodate the tensions created by secessionist movements in Europe and abroad. So a few things with regard to international law. As I said, I'm not going to spend much time on it because this is not the main part of the paper. If there are any questions, I'm happy to reply to it later on. Now, as I said, generally speaking, what we see is that the EU legal order follows, by and large, the international opposition when it comes to the right of self-determination. What is the problem with the international opposition? Is what Crawford has actually pointed with this very accurate description that self-determination, the right of self-determination when it comes to international law is lex lata, but lex obscura. So that it is established law, so we know that it exists, but actually it's obscure law. So it's a bit of a shady situation. It's not shady when it comes to non-self-governing entities. It's not shady when it comes to colonized people. There it's undisputed. But when it comes to other categories, so people that are not under colonial definition, then it becomes more shady. Now, self-determination is not international law. It's something that has developed during the years. And it's interesting that to note that the idea before, before the Second World War that was, and we see that from the Commission of Rapporteurs with regard to the Åland Islands, was that it was not so much a rule of international law, but more a principle of justice and liberty. However, and again, now I'm going to go through all those very, very quickly. After the Second World War, we see a gradual legalization, or codification, if you wish, to this legal principle. We have in the UN Charter all those clear references to the right of self-determination, including Article 1. We have those specific provisions that apply to the rights of people under colonial domination, where it's clear that there is an undisputed right to self-determination. And of course, we have the only common article, the only common right in the International Bill of Rights, in the two international covenants, Article 1, which recognizes the right of self-determination. But it's not only that, it's not only the codification that takes place through those international legal instruments, it's also the codification that, it's also the development through case law, right? And we have all those cases, like Namibia, the Western Sahara cases that recognize this right of self-determination, but more importantly, we have the case of East Timor that makes clear that actually, although the right of self-determination is undisputed with regard to non-self-governing population, it is also erga omnes. It has an erga omnes character. So it applies to everyone. And we also have this recent case of Chagos Islands last year, which again makes the same point. Now, if we could sum up the right of self-determination for all the other peoples that they don't find themselves within a non-self-governing entity, so for the majority of the people, we can sum it up with those two judgments. One, the famous judgment of the Canadian Supreme Court, and then the ICJ judgment on Kosovo. So you all know what the court said there, the Supreme Court, that when it comes to, so outside the colonial context, normally the right of self-determination would be exercised through internal self-determination, but the Kosovo judgment said, it is not, unilateral declarations of independence are not by themselves breaching international law. So to sum up what we have seen and what we know from international law, and I'm summing it up because my argument is that actually EU law pretty much follows the same logic. The right of self-determination is undisputed when it comes to non-self-governing entities. For the rest, generally speaking, when we're talking about democratic societies, normally this right should be exercised through internal self-determination, but when it comes to external self-determination, declaring independence by itself is not illegal. So what I'm going to show now is that EU law is respecting very clearly the undisputed right of those people that find themselves in colonial domination. It has showed remarkable flexibility to adapt and accommodate the different systems of internal self-determination. So how in the different states we have different divisions of power or a special status for some regions in order to allow them to exercise this right of internal self-determination. And at the end, what I'm going to show that even in case of external self-determination, EU law has all the instruments to accommodate even the exercise, even the expression of external self-determination that is successful. So with regard to the right of self-determination in non-self-governing territories, we see that the first and foremost, what we see is that EU law has found a way to deal with how those territories exercise the right to independence. And we saw that in the case of Algeria. To make a long story short, in the beginning of the creation of the EU, Algeria had was not quite a colony under French law, but it had this particular constitutional relationship with France, and as such was part of the EU. When it became independent, of course, it found itself somehow outside the remit. So the EU legally respected the path to independence of this state. However, and this is very interesting to note, for more than many years, almost 15 years, there was even an accommodation, a transitional period that had de facto transitional period that was created in order to make sure that Algeria would actually transition in a smooth way between being a part of EU law and the new association agreement that was created in the 70s in order to establish the relationship. Beyond the very special example of Algeria, we see that when it comes to non-self-governing entities under the Chapter 11 of the UN Charter, the EU has created a special category of overseas territories where they have created a very special legal regime applying to all those territories, where EU law is partially applying, or at least applies with many derogations. And this has allowed for those territories that enjoy this very special status under international law to enjoy also a very special status under EU law. In fact, the Court of Justice, in at least the General Court in those two cases, and that's the third bullet point that had to do with Gibraltar, recognized or at least took into account the special status of Gibraltar under Chapter 11. So we see how the status of non-self-governing entity under international law, how it has been translated and accommodated through EU law. Now, when it comes to internal self-determination, what we see is two things. The first thing that we see is that the main way that the EU has dealt and has accommodated internal self-determination is through derogations in primary law. I'm not going to go into detail, but I'm happy to discuss it later in the questions. The two examples here is the Åland Islands. Well, there are many examples, but two that are important is the Åland Islands. So a region of an archipelago of Swedish-speaking, mainly Swedish-speaking islands that belong to Finland, where there is a special international treaty that recognizes their right of self-determination. There was a protocol, there was a special protocol when the metropolitan state Finland joined the EU. And what was interesting is that there are important derogations in fundamental freedoms that were accepted by the EU in order to make sure that this very special status that that the Åland Islands enjoy under the right of internal self-determination would be also respected under EU law. Very similar provisions, so provisions that were derogating from primary law of the EU and particularly from fundamental freedoms were also accepted with regard to Cyprus in case Cyprus had joined the EU as a whole back in 2004. So the EU, when it comes to the internal, to the right of internal self-determination, has accepted even permanent derogations in fundamental freedoms, in the four fundamental freedoms, in order to make sure that they accommodate those systems. Is there a limit to that? We don't know for sure, but I guess the limits are coming from the application of Article 2. So in other words, derogations to primary law cannot go further than the respect to the fundamental values of Article 2. It doesn't seem that the EU would accept derogations in primary law when somehow they are connected with those fundamental values. And the example that I can give is the example of Bosnia with the Shadids and Finch case, where the EU has actually added some conditionality, has said that it would not accept Bosnia that has not actually amended its constitution and not taken into account Shadid. So to sum up this point, derogations are available. Even with regard to fundamental freedoms, the four fundamental freedoms, the free movement of capital in particular has been derogated from in the case of Åland Islands and the free movement of services. But those derogations cannot touch on Article 2. When a member state is, when it joins the EU and when there is no derogation in primary law, so when the member state has not negotiated derogations in the Treaty of Accession, then what we see is that there's the general protection provided by Article 2, Article 4.2, which says that the EU would respect the national constitutional identity of member states. But it seems that this kind of respect is not unfettered. And the limits from the case law, from cases like the Belgian welfare system case or the last case, it seems that here, and when there are no derogations in the Act of Accession, it seems that the limits are that the EU would not accept, would respect the right of internal self-determination to the extent that there are no breaches to fundamental freedoms. Right? So the EU doesn't seem, or at least the Court of Justice doesn't seem so amenable to extend this protection of Article 4, Paragraph 2 to a situation where the fundamental freedoms would be breached. There is the case law of the state aid that could be seen as a partial exception, but generally speaking, when a member state has not already negotiated derogations from primary law, it seems that the right of self-determination, internal self-determination, doesn't go as far, and the respect to the right of internal self-determination doesn't go as far as accepting breaches of fundamental freedom. When it comes to external self-determination, I think that the limit comes to the consensual or non-consensual nature, whether the right of external self-determination has come through a consensual and democratic process or not. If it has not, in particular, if there is an act of aggression that has led to the exercise of external self-determination, like in the case of Western Sahara or of Cyprus or to a certain extent of Palestine, it seems that the EU would not, it would follow again the international law and would not recognize any kind of right of external self-determination that somehow linked with acts of aggression and with non-consensual, with a non-consensual, non-democratic exercise of this right. However, and this actually this is the case. This is a case that is very recent. We see that even with regard to that, there's some wiggle room. So there is this case that I have as a second bullet point coming from the General Court, Spain against the Commission, where Spain has argued that the term third country should not apply to Kosovo for the obvious reasons, because Kosovo has not been recognized by a number of member states, including Spain. The General Court in this case interestingly said that the term third country goes beyond and is wider than the term recognized state under international law. So it includes even other entities that have exercised somehow a right of external self-determination, including Kosovo. Today, and as we speak, Spain has decided to appeal this case. So this case will be heard now by the Court of Justice itself. So we'll see whether the Court of Justice will actually adopt the position of the General Court, and we'll see whether the Court of Justice will accept that when it comes to entities that have exercised the right of external self-determination, there is some wiggle room about how the EU recognizes them, even when not all the member states recognize the same. When it comes to the consensual process, I think that the only when it comes to a process that is that has led to a consensual and democratic exercise of the right of external self-determination, I think the only question is whether such an exercise of consensual right of external self-determination, consensual secession, means also a continuous membership of the EU. So I think that is undisputed that when you have a consensual and democratic process, like in the case of Czech Republic and Slovakia, the EU doesn't have a problem to actually go through the normal accession negotiations. It's not an issue. The issue comes when, of course, such a consensual process and democratic process takes place within the remit of the EU, so within a member state. And the main question is whether there is a need for those regions that have become states through a consensual process. We don't have yet historical example. Scotland is the closest one. Whether they have to follow an Article 49 process, so they have to join the queue of the candidate states, or we can just amend the treaties in order to accommodate them and to help them continue being members of the EU. In my writing, I have taken the position that as EU law stands at the moment, Article 49, because it's a specialized provision, because it actually is lex specialis when it comes to the accession of new member states, and those states will be new subjects of international law. It is Article 49 that should be applied. Now, there is an argument to be made that this runs counter or doesn't sit comfortably with my previous argument about Article 4.2, which says that the EU should respect the constitutional identity of a member state. And to the extent that a secession, a concessional democratic secession, is part of that constitutional identity, the EU should have the obligation to engage with in negotiations with a new state, even before it's independent. I have a great sympathy with this argument, and I think that it's a good argument that actually supports the idea of continuity, and it makes sense from a political point of view. But what I would say is that, at most to my mind, this Article 4, Paragraph 2, asks and requires the EU to engage in good faith discussion with the new state, with the region that won't, that will become state, that has voted for independence, even before its independence. But when it comes to the act of the accession, I cannot see, as the law stands at the moment, how Article 44 can be used instead of Article 49. It might be the case that in the future the member states will actually amend the treaties. But as the law stands at the moment, I cannot see how Article 44 can be 48 can be used instead of Article 49. I mean, largely this is not from a political point of view, it doesn't make any difference because both articles need unanimity. But legally speaking, I think that Article 49 is the correct legal basis. Final points. I think I have managed to show, I hope, that the EU legal order is flexible enough to deal with secessionist frictions and tensions and to accommodate. And I think that the argument that has been put forward by many people that secession by itself is contrary to the European ethos is ahistorical. And it is ahistorical because it actually doesn't take into account the very raison d'etre of the EU, which is not to... the very raison d'etre of the EU is to actually create a pragmatic framework where competing nationalism will cooperate. It doesn't negate competing nationalism. It puts them all together in order to make sure that they cooperate and they don't resort to violence. In that sense, to my mind, saying that secession is contrary to the ethos of the EU is ahistorical because the EU has always been a project that tries to accommodate this kind of tension. So the flexibility of EU law when it comes to those big political issues, in fact, it is one of those expressions and one of those demonstrations of this ancient idea that the EU is mainly a peace plan. And in fact, it very much coincides with those principles of the EU, according to which the EU should be, on the one hand, promote peace, but also, on the other hand, respect international law. And in the way that they have actually accommodated the right of self-determination, to a certain extent, they have achieved. Thank you very much.